and welcome to Good Life, the health show with me, Pooja. Well, this is a show that focuses on providing you with solutions to your health-related issues, lifestyle, and much more. Well, viewers, diabetes can strike anyone from any walk of life. And if proper precautionary measures are not taken on time, then diabetes can cause blindness, kidney failure, heart failure, and stroke, and whatnot. And to discuss more on this, we have with us in studio Dr. Bhaskar Neog from Health Hospital to discuss more on the topic which we have taken, that is diabetes. And in between, I would like to tell you viewers that our phone lines are open and the numbers are flashed on your television screens. So if you have any questions on diabetes, if you want to ask anything about diabetes, the doctor is here and he will ask and he will give you all the answers on your queries. So not to waste any more time, I'll straight away move to him and talk more about the topic. So doctor, welcome to Good Life, the health show. So today the topic which we have taken is diabetes, and it is really seen in every household these days. It's a very common topic which we have taken today. Yeah. So first of all, if in a general a person wants to know what is diabetes, what do you have to say on that?
Yeah, diabetes is actually, you see, it's a metabolic disorder where the blood sugar levels are not under control.
Okay.
So basically, when a normal person, his blood sugar level after eating something, so it used to remain within a optimum level.
Okay.
So in diabetic patients or person who has got diabetes, it used to go more than the normal range. But so for the normal blood sugar values, we see that the fasting is in the range of 70 to 110. And the PP values, the PP is basically the postprandial blood sugar, which we used to test after eating something. Basically after 2 hours it is tested. So it should be less than 140 milligram per DL. So if these values are deranged, if it is more, if it is on the higher side, then we can say that the person is having diabetes. And diabetes per se, it is basically, it can be due to insulin deficiency and it can be due to insulin resistance. So basically there are two types of diabetes and the other one is gestational diabetes. So speaking of the two types, one is type 1 diabetes and the other one is type 2.
Type 1 and type 2.
Type 1 and type 2 diabetes. In type 1 diabetes, what we see is that there is total insulin deficiency. The pancreas, which is there in the human body, it is not able to secrete insulin. The sufficient adequate amount of insulin is not secreted in the body, which leads to increase in the blood sugar levels. And in type 2 diabetes, basically what we see in the Indian population, or basically what we find is that mainly we find that type 2 diabetes cases. 95% of the cases are type 2 diabetes cases, and rest 5 to 6% are type 1 diabetes cases. So what happens is that in type 2 diabetes, basically there is insulin resistance. So insulin per se, it helps the blood glucose to enter inside the cells of the body, and it helps to convert it into energy, this sugar. It is converted into energy with the help of insulin. So when there is insulin resistance, this blood glucose, the sugar, it gets accumulated in the blood, and it leads to high blood sugar. So this is basically in a nutshell about diabetes.
So this is just a basic information one has to keep in mind about diabetes. So doctor, if we ask you about like how to diagnose diabetes and how a person can know that he or she is suffering from diabetes, what are the symptoms and signs which is commonly seen in a diabetic patient?
See, first of all, sometimes some patient may present with overt symptoms of diabetes. So basically they include increased urination, then increased thirst, increased hunger, then weight gain, or in some cases we can see that there is excessive weight loss, then extreme fatigability or weakness. So these are the basic signs and symptoms with which if a person comes to us, then at least we can clinically judge and we can let him know that he may have diabetes. But some person may come to you without any symptoms. He may have some vague symptoms like body aches and pains, then joint pain. He may have some kind of skin disorders as well. So in these cases, we need to test their blood sugar levels. So we need to do these tests to confirm the diagnosis.
So if any of the person finds out the signs and symptoms, whatever you have mentioned right now, so one should not opt, because I have seen some of the patients, or I have seen some of the people out there that if they find out some signs and symptoms, they start, what they do is like they stop eating sugar totally. They stop eating rice. So are these methods or are these self-examination necessary, or they should always go to a doctor and just have a consultation?
That should be totally avoided. Even if they don't want to go and visit a specialist, they should at least go and visit or approach their family doctor. Or a physician who is just nearby to him. So at least and get their blood sugar, sugar test done, then the routine test like get their BP checked up and the systemic examination at least once. So after that, after consulting with the particular doctor,
okay,
at least if he advises the tests, mm-hmm, he or she can go through this test, and mm-hmm, then we can at least come to a particular or definite diagnosis that mm-hmm, he is having diabetes, or if he is pre-diabetic also, we can come to know about that after getting his blood sugar test done.
And that patient would be cured soon maybe, because like if a pre-diabetic has come to you, that symptoms have just started up, then you can at least apply.
You see, when someone is in the pre-diabetic state, at least we can prevent that diabetes.
Very true.
We can prevent, if that person is going to have diabetes in the near future, we can at least prolong the period.
Okay.
By maintaining proper diet, then by doing some regular physical activities or exercise, at least we can prolong the time period. Mm-hmm. Invariably, he or she is going to have diabetes if he is not maintaining those lifestyle, mm-hmm, if he is not maintaining proper diet, mm-hmm, then that person is bound to have diabetes.
Right.
And if he goes to some, basically what people do is that they start taking some Ayurvedic medicines on their own, mm-hmm, and they start to change their diet schedule. But
that's what the self-examination and self-medication has been started by.
That should be totally avoided, yeah.
Very true. Okay, so you were talking about that physical activity is very important, which we see have become very less in these days because everyone has become busy in their life.
Yes.
And so physical activity has become zero, we can say. Mm-hmm. So in that mode of time, if suppose someone is having a sitting job and he's continuously sitting for 5 to 6 hours, so is that person also maybe prone to diabetes? Or?
Yes, definitely. Because you see, nowadays, these sort of persons basically who are leading a sedentary lifestyle, they are always in the risk of developing obesity.
Okay.
Once a person is obese, he has got more chances of developing type 2 diabetes, which I told you, which is more common in our Indian population or everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
It is more common. Type 2 diabetes is more common.
Okay.
So, and type 1 is basically, it is kind of autoimmune. And speaking about this type 2 diabetes, what the American Diabetic Association, they recommend to go for any form of physical activity 30 minutes every day, at least 5 to 6 days a week.
Even
if he doesn't gain, even if he doesn't get adequate time to go for activities daily, at least 5 days a week for 30 minutes is enough.
Okay. So what kind of activity can you mention?
Any form of physical activity, whether it is in the form of running or walking or cycling, going out for a jogging.
Mm-hmm.
So any form of activities is, and that is okay. And if he goes out for any kind of rigorous physical activity, then 75 minutes per week is enough.
Okay, okay. Because we have seen that we have been surrounded by lots of technologies out there.
Yeah.
So our physical activity has become very less, and we have seen that machines have taken up human.
Definitely.
So in that mode of time, the things which we used to do with our hands, nowadays machines have taken that place.
Everything.
So in that mode of time, sometimes it's better to do with our hands, isn't it?
Definitely.
Some like kitchen hole out things and or some kind of other physical activity.
Any household works, like sometimes someone may prefer to go and do some gardening activities, then you can wash clothes at home. And if you don't feel like doing anything, then you can just go out for an evening walk.
Or to buy something,
or
just to a nearby
yeah,
shop,
yeah.
You can just walk and you can go.
Any form of physical activity is going to do. At least 30 minutes per day for 5 to 6 days a week. That is most essential.
Okay. So doctor, many kinds of patient comes to you. You must have a lot of experience. So is there any kind of tough experience you had with you when a patient came to you and you had a tough time to make that patient understand that you have not been diagnosed that much of diabetes, but it can be cured? Is there any kind of like interesting facts which have been related to your medical
thing? Most of the time what happens is that once a patient comes to you and he is diagnosed with diabetes, say he is having his blood sugar levels very high, then we put him on medicines.
Okay.
Initially we start off with diet and lifestyle modifications, but once these fail, then we start him on medicines. So after starting these medicines, maybe after one month or one and a half months or 2 months, when we call him again for the follow-up visit, most of the patients, what I see, basically even if literate persons also, what I have seen and what I have found, they stop taking these medicines.
Okay.
They used to think that diabetes is kind of a disease like malaria or typhoid, which has got a natural time period
to get cured.
So people, they don't realize the fact and they don't really basically know that diabetes is a chronic disease. Okay, it can just be under control, but it can never be cured. Diabetes can never be cured. It can either be prevented at an early stage or it can be treated to
but you can keep it a balanced check.
Yeah, to maintain the blood sugar levels at an optimum level to prevent further complications.
Okay.
So these patients, when they come, we have to keep them explaining again and again, and and then we have to counsel them properly so that you need to take these medicines always till the time you are alive, because diabetes is not a kind of disease which is going to get cured like other infectious diseases. So you have to take these medicines.
Okay, so how difficult it was for you to make them good consultation, because like there are some patients you have difficult with
sometimes
them.
It's really very difficult because he used to come and ask me various questions and he has got lots of queries and doubts. He used to come and tell me that if I am having my blood sugar levels within the normal limits, then I should stop taking these medicines.
Okay.
Rather, I'll be having some other side effects because of these medicines. He used to explain me. So then again, I'll have to counsel him, and then again, I have to make him explain that diabetes in the initial stages, basically in the first 5 or 6 years, the patient is not going to get any form of complications.
Okay.
So after that, if his blood sugar levels are not within the control or within not the normal limits, then he will start developing other complications like neuropathies he'll be developing, which is related to the nerve. Okay, then he'll be having retinopathy problems, then nephropathy problems. Nephropathy is basically the kidney part. The kidney will get destroyed, or it will get damaged.
So it will be related to some other things.
Yeah, in due course of time, because high levels of sugar in the blood, that will cause damage to these organs.
Okay. That one has to keep a check every time, and if suppose they have been diagnosed, so proper medication is very important.
Proper medication is very important. Along with proper medication, you need to have proper diet. And most important is physical activity. Daily physical activity is a must for any diabetic person, and a proper balanced diet. So with all these three things, at least one can lead a normal lifestyle.
Okay. If we talk about the medication, if suppose you have suggested or you have given a pill to be used every day, to be taken every day. So if suppose 1 or 2 days the diabetic or the glucose measurement is very less and the person is properly treated, so is it necessary that one should stop the pill or they should continue with the pill? Is it necessary?
No, it depends. That is why you see we always, when we see a diabetic patient, we always advise him to keep a glucometer at home.
Okay.
So that once he feels any kind of, because diabetic patients, because this diabetic, once you are on a diabetic medication, on any form of diabetic medication, whether it is oral or in the form of insulin therapy, that person, whether he or she is prone to develop hypoglycemia. Hypoglycemia means low level of blood glucose. Okay. If it is less than 70, especially he needs to visit the nearby hospital or the nearby clinic, or he needs to go to his doctor. If it is less than 100, then at least he can manage himself at home by taking some fruit or sweet items or any form of sugary glucose containing items. Okay. So these patients, we always advise them to monitor their blood glucose. And once their blood glucose comes down less than the normal range, we advise them either to call us up, or at least you can go to your nearby hospitals or clinics, so the dose adjustments can be made accordingly. Because sometimes it happens, one may take the medicine and he may not take the adequate quantity of food.
Right.
And sometimes what
it
happens
has to
is
be
that
balanced.
It has to be balanced. And sometimes what happens, especially with the ladies, they take their medicines on time and they forget to take the food. So that will end up in hypoglycemia. So that is also a problem.
And if you talk about the medication, you were saying a proper check should be done on the medication.
Definitely.
So how long, but how frequently one should have a proper check on their diabetic medication?
See, sugar levels, if one is well controlled, if saying whether well controlled, what I mean that we need to check their HbA1c. There is a test called HbA1c. So that means the glycated hemoglobin. It gives the full blood glucose estimation for the last 3 months.
Okay.
So if their HbA1c levels, what we prefer to keep any diabetic patient, the HbA1c level should be less than 7.5. So if it is less than 7.5, we can tell him, and if the fasting and PP are under control, we can say that at least the person is having, or that patient is at least maintaining a good diabetic control. So in this subset of patients, we can tell them to check their blood glucose levels, fasting and PP every 3 months. Then their kidney status.
In 3 months?
Yeah, in 3 months. Every 3 months, at least they should get their blood sugar and the blood pressure checked. Because invariably, every diabetic patient is prone to develop hypertension and other cardiac disease. So that is the thing. And regarding the kidney part, if the creatinine level is within the normal limits, then at least they should get their kidney function status checked every once in a year. And eyes should be checked every once in a year.
Okay. So these are some of the important points. I'm sure viewers must be listening to this. These are some of the important points you must keep in your mind. You should always have a proper check on your health issues. And once I would like to mention that our phone lines are open and the numbers are flashed on your television screens. And we have taken up the topic which is seen in every household, that is diabetes. Dr. Bhaskar Neog is here and he will be giving you all the answers. So if you have any queries, just call on the numbers which are flashed on your television screens and your questions will be answered by Dr. out here. So Dr., coming back to you again, if we talk about the diet chart, if we talk about the physical activity you have already mentioned, but if you talk about the diet, so is it necessary that one should stop totally having sugar or one should stop totally
Nowadays, what the recent guidelines, they tell us that there is actually in these diabetic patients, they should have small quantities of meals and at regular intervals.
Okay.
So basically, they should cut down the refined carbohydrates.
Okay.
They should not. They should totally avoid junk food. All these sugary form of drinks like and any form of beverages, that is to be totally avoided. Mm-hmm. But other than that, if someone is taking fruits, fruits also contain sugar.
Yeah.
But they can take fruits which are having a low glycemic index.
Okay.
Because you see, one may think that if you have a banana, then that is going to increase your blood sugar level. Mm-hmm. But banana per se it contains fiber as well, so that is good for the health.
Mm-hmm.
So if a person is a diabetic person who is maintaining a proper diet, he or she, I'm telling about an average Indian male or female.
Okay.
He or she needs to take in a daily intake of 1800 to 2000 kilocalories diet.
Okay.
So. And 50% of the diet, that calorie should come from carbohydrates. But that carbohydrates should not be refined carbohydrates.
Okay.
It should refined carbohydrates like maida, then white bread, all this should be totally avoided as far as possible.
So rice can be taken?
Rice can be taken. Rice
but
can
in
be
a
taken.
Small quantity?
Yeah, quantity should be, we should measure the quantity. Because you see once that person is allowed to take 1800 or 2000 calories, he can consume that 2000 calories in the morning itself, or during the lunchtime, or during the dinner time. Mm-hmm. So that depends upon him, how he is going to divide those calories in between his meals and during the breakfast and during lunch and during the dinner time. So that is where the role of dietitian comes in. Good dietitian.
And good dietitian. And we have also seen that some people always get annoyed when their food habits have to be changed because of the diabetes diagnosis and they will have a set of diet chart. So in that mode of time, how do you handle those patients and do they come and complain to you?
Proper counseling. Sometimes some patients, they come and lie. But proper counseling is required to make them understand because you are the one who is going to suffer if you are not going to follow all these steps. Because he is the one who is prone to develop nephropathy, like kidney damage, I said. Then his eyes will be damaged in the form of retinopathy. Then nerves will be getting damaged in the form of neuropathy. Then he may have some other cardiac disease as well. Then he can end up with a stroke. So these are the problems that he or she is going to have. So we try to explain and we try to counsel them from our side as far as possible.
So do you tell them about these things that it might hamper your kidney and
definitely,
your eyes?
Definitely.
So you tell them
as,
clearly.
As soon as the patient comes, as soon as they come and once they are diagnosed with diabetes, it is our duty to tell them.
Sure.
And it is our duty to let them know what are the complications that they may be having if they are not maintaining their proper blood sugar levels in the due course of time.
And as you have already mentioned that in 3 months of span of time that one should have a proper checkup. And nowadays the kids are already available, very easily available, and they can keep it at home, isn't it?
Yeah.
Or if they want to go to some of the nearby medical stores, and they can also apply and they can also go and have a check on that.
Yeah.
And if necessary, they can have a check with a physician and a doctor and then get a proper consultation.
Definitely,
isn't it?
Yeah.
So doctor, what more you want to add on the topic? Any other experiences you want to share with us on the entire topic?
See, basically diabetes, I would like to say it is a very simple kind of disease if it is maintained properly. If you are keeping your blood glucose levels within the normal limit, it is not going to get you in any form of trouble or any form of problems.
Okay.
But if that blood sugar levels are not maintained, then that person is prone to develop all the complications which I already told you. And that too, sometimes we see patients who were not diagnosed earlier. They were not aware that they were having diabetes. So once they come and get their disease diagnosed, it it already comes to such a stage that it's quite late.
So it should their be known very, are, at a very early age.
Their kidneys are already damaged.
Okay.
Then their heart is not in a good shape.
Hmm.
Then their nerves, then their eyes, everything is, all the organs are totally
already
messed
affected.
Up. Okay. Hmm. So in these patients, we need to treat them in a very aggressive way.
Okay.
Other than that, if it is diagnosed at an earlier stage, in the initial stage, if one is diagnosed, we can control diabetes.
Mm-hmm.
Nowadays, many medicines are available in the market.
Mm-hmm.
So along with these medicines and proper diet, then proper physical activities, so it can be managed and controlled.
Okay.
Because you see, Wasim Akram, he was diagnosed with diabetes maybe around when he was just 18 or 19 years old.
Mm-hmm.
So he was a case of type 1 diabetes.
Okay.
And type 1 diabetes, invariably, any patient diagnosed with type 1 diabetes, they need to have insulin.
Okay.
Insulin is the only mainstay of treatment for a case of type 1 diabetes.
Okay, that was my next question, that who are the patients or who are the members, who are the people necessary for getting this insulin?
Yeah, so he, you can see he is still leading a normal life. He played cricket for his entire lifetime, so he is leading almost a normal life. So basically these type 1 diabetic patients, they invariably require insulin. Then type 2 diabetes patients who are on these oral anti-hypoglycemic drugs for a long period of time.
Okay.
In this subset of patients also, at some point of time, there, in those patients also, we need to use insulin. When they are beta cell, beta cells are there in the pancreas. Okay. So when the beta cells get totally exhausted, the insulin production is totally stopped.
Okay.
So as I was telling you that in type 2 diabetes, basically the diabetes is mainly due to insulin resistance. Okay. So once we come over that part, insulin resistance part, in the later stages, even if you are getting good control of diabetes, what happens is that in those subset of patients also, in type 2 diabetic cases, sometimes these beta cells get totally exhausted, and in those cases, we need to use insulin in type 2 diabetes patients as well.
Okay, okay. So we already had a word of many things regarding the diabetes, but a question comes in my mind and in everybody's mind, but this diabetes, earlier we used to see that it used to be diagnosed only in the very old age or many younger age, but nowadays it has been seen in kids also. So what do you have to say on that? Any of the kids you have come over in your any of the medical treatment?
Yeah, we get type 1 cases. Those are basically type 1 diabetic cases.
Okay.
And India, you see, India has become the diabetic capital of the world. In 2010,
diabetic capital of the
world. In 2010, there were around 50 million diabetics in India. In 2018, now, it is expected around, India has got around 60 to 62 million diabetics.
Okay.
And by the year 2030, it is going to double. Every and out of the total population of India, almost seven or eight percent of the population is having diabetes.
Okay.
So it has become like an epidemic. Even though it is a chronic disease, even though it is a non-infectious disease, it has become just like an epidemic.
Okay. So, so do you also organize some of the camps and awareness camps for these kind of patients and to aware the people out there that what they have to do it? Because as you have mentioned the figures, it's very huge figure you have mentioned.
Yeah, we organize such kind of camps in our hospital on a regular basis. In fact, last month we had a diabetic awareness camp for 1 month.
Okay.
We did all our blood tests and blood sugar tests for free. Then we did the counseling part. Then our consultation part was also free. And we saw around maybe 500 to 600 diabetic patients in our hospital.
Okay. And they must be also telling other people also that there is an awareness camp going on.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
You should come and join it.
Yeah, yeah.
So what kind of response do you get?
We got patients from coming all the way from Upper Assam, coming from different northeastern parts.
So it was a good response.
Assam. Yeah, it was totally good response.
Okay. So when you make this or when you arrange these kind of awareness programs or any kind of camps you set up, so what are the things do you do the pre-preparations and what are the things you doctors have a discussions on it? We also want to know on that.
Basically, you see, we try to give them from our side the best possible treatment or the opportunities or
a
the
clear tests. Cut information.
Yeah, clear cut information. And most importantly, the awareness about diabetes.
Okay.
That diabetes has become such an epidemic in today's world that it is, if it is not controlled at this stage, then the next subsequent generations, they will not be able to lead a normal lifestyle because nowadays, along with the advancement of newer technologies and with such hectic jobs and with so much of stress and anxiety problems. So these people, basically what we do is that we try to counsel them and then we try to give them whatever is possible from our side so that at least they also have an awareness about this non-communicable disease which is spreading like wildfire. And at least they can go and educate some other people that diabetes is such a kind of disease. Mm-hmm. Basically, it is called a silent killer medical. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And earlier, we used to see that if a patient is having any kind of problem, they just go to a doctor, they will get the treatment, they will get the medication, and they'll come back. But nowadays, this consultation, counseling is very important, which I have seen. It is in every part of the disease, one has to get a proper consultation because people are so confused. People are having their own kind of notion
about
the
disease. Then, internet is there, Google is there. People used to come up with various ideas.
They already take up many information.
Yeah,
they
from
are
the
not
internet itself, then they have got a lot of queries. They used to come and ask us, and we need to address them, and we need to counsel them, and we need to make them understand that what is the actual truth or what is the fact that lies behind this.
Because sometimes internet helps you, but sometimes it makes you more confused also, isn't it, doctor?
Definitely. Yeah. Yeah,
because there are so many kinds of information, so many informations lined up that you will be thinking that which to follow and which not to follow. So there are doctors, there are practitioners, there are physicians who are there to help you out, isn't it? So I'm sure the viewers who must be watching this show of Good Life, the health show, the topic which we had taken today, diabetes. So it was an important topic we were just discussing with Bhaskar Neog, and he was telling us about the diabetes, an important topic which is seen in every household these days. So doctor, if you want to add something else and any discussions on this, because this is a topic, diabetes, if I also find some of kind of signs and symptoms. Okay, we have a phone call, we'll just take the phone call.
Okay.
Hello, who's calling?
Hello, I'm calling from Dispur, Asa Ahmed.
Yeah, please share your question.
I'm Asa Ahmed calling from Dispur.
Yes, we can hear you. Please tell your question.
Yeah. A few days ago, I tested my blood.
Okay.
I tested my blood through glucometer.
Okay.
First thing, blood sugar, it came 132. Actually, I'm not a diabetic.
Okay. So, what did the result come out? 132. Hello? Actually, first of all, can you please reduce the volume of your television screen?
Yes, I'm reducing the volume.
Yeah, then please repeat your question. You have tested?
Then I went for HbA1c test.
Okay, what was your HbA1c test result?
That result came as 5.9.
Okay. And what about your fasting and PP?
No, I did fasting only. It came 132.
No, you need to do your PP blood sugar as well, because you see.
But I went for this HbA1c.
Yeah, HbA1c. You see, HbA1c is not specific in all subset of patients. If you are having any kind of blood disorders, or if you are having low blood hemoglobin, then your HbA1c sometimes it shows an error result also. But as your reports say, 5.9 is a pre-diabetic level, okay? If it is more than 6.5, we can tell that it is a diabetic case. We can confirm that.
Okay.
But your fasting is slightly on the higher side, so you need to check the PP blood sugar as well. And you need to visit a doctor, actually.
Okay, I'm sure you must have got your answer. So you need to check your PP as well as just have doctor had mentioned. So can you please just repeat it, what the person has to do it?
Okay.
Thank you so much for calling.
Basically, I think he has to go to his personal physician and go and get his blood sugar test checked once again. Because sometimes what happens is that this glucometer, they show some kind of error results.
Okay.
So it is not 100% sensitive in all cases.
So one should not get scared if something has come out. So
because
one should have a double
if
check.
If the fasting is more than 126, then we can tell that the person is having diabetes. But with just one test, we cannot confirm. As he's already a new, he's saying that he's diagnosed, tested it for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
And his HbA1c, which is 5.9 is not a diabetic level. It is, in fact, a pre-diabetic state.
Mm-hmm.
Because if it is more than 6.5, we can tell that at least that person is having diabetes.
Mm-hmm.
And HbA1c, it gives a blood sugar estimation for the last 3 months, that is glycated hemoglobin. But that is also, you see, that the specificity of HbA1c is not 100%, because if a person is having any form of blood problems, mm-hmm. like if he is having low hemoglobin, if mm-hmm. he is having any mm-hmm. other forms of blood dyscrasias like mm-hmm. HBE trait, or if he is having hemoglobin E disease, pregnant okay. woman. Mm-hmm. So in those subset of patients, the HbA1c is not that accurate.
Okay, so basically one should go and have a proper check. Yeah. Already he had a check,
but
he's
done
concerned
his fasting.
For
he should better get his PP blood sugar checked.
Okay, okay. Okay, thank you so much, doctor, for coming to our show. It was really nice talking to you, and I'm sure the viewers who must be watching our show must have got all your answers, at least some of the basic information you have got on diabetes. And one has to have a check on your diabetes measurements, but the thing is that if you have to check at home, you must also have a good second check or a double check with the physicians out there, because you will get a clear-cut number and then a proper medication can be started on. But on that note, we'll slip into a short break, but do come back soon because we have lots more on the other side. Welcome back, viewers. You're still watching Good Life, the health show with me, Pooja. And it's time now to move on to a subject which plays a very crucial role in our lives. And in order for our bodies to function properly and stay healthy, it is important that we follow a good, nutritious diet. And today, the topic which we have taken is also the talk of the town, that is jaundice and what you have to eat when you are diagnosed with jaundice and what not to eat. So for that, we have our nutrition expert, Tina Baby Borwa, who will enlighten us on the topic and give us valuable inputs. So Tina, once again, welcome to Good Life, the health show. So today the topic which we have taken is jaundice. And we have seen that whenever a person is having jaundice, total stop of all the good foods and they has to go for this boiled food. So is it necessary? First of all, what you would like to put on that?
Actually, now the concept is little changed.
Oh, the concept is changed?
Yes.
Okay.
In terms of like liver disease. Hmm. So it's a, yeah, it's very true that whenever someone is diagnosed as a jaundice, we completely stop taking all the types of food items and stick to a boiled diet.
Stop taking oil, stop taking fried foods.
Yeah, right. And like fish, chicken, everything has been stopped and totally on like completely boiled, like maybe boiled rice, boiled dal and boiled vegetable. That's the common diet plan of a jaundice patient. And but one thing is that now the concept is changed and it is that if you are diagnosed as a jaundice, jaundice, as we all know, that it is a yellow pigmentation of the skin or the white part of the eye, you know, discoloration of the yellowish. When the pigment bilirubin that increases in the blood, that is that time it is a person is diagnosed as a jaundice. So as we all know that bilirubin is been metabolized and it is been taken out by the liver. So somewhat it is like related, jaundice is directly related to the liver disease. But when the liver is destructed while functioning certain due to certain factors, maybe due to drug induced or maybe due to the infection like hepatitis, viral infection and all, so a person may get into jaundice.
Okay,
or maybe like some alcoholic people also we have seen excessive of drinking alcohol. So later on when the liver function is been disturbed, so at that time the jaundice may arise in the in that particular person.
Okay. Yeah.
Now, when a person is been diagnosed as a jaundice, it is not necessary that you have to stop taking all sort of like, good foods.
Good foods.
Yeah. The dietary plan of a jaundice patient should be high fiber diet. High fiber diet, as we all know, the whole cereals is allowed, like maybe multigrain atta, maybe atta from the corn, or ragi, bajra, all these things can be taken. And also the red atta, which is commonly available. And then you have to increase the intake of fluid. The person has to keep oneself very dehydrated. Means dehydration should not be there. One has to keep oneself like hydrated by taking a sufficient amount of fluid. It should be more or less 2 liter at least per day. The fluid can be, fruit juices. It may be like plain water, okay, then curd is very, very beneficial in terms of, because it is a probiotic. I always keep on taking, telling that, you know, probiotic means good bacteria that helps in your digestion. So yogurt and curd is very, very, you know, helpful in terms of like curing the jaundice. So, but it has to be made from skim milk, completely fat-free milk.
So that has to be kept in mind. And just to stop you in between, I would just like to tell the viewers out there, we are just start our conversation on what to eat and what not to eat on jaundice. It's just not only the boiled food you should go for it, but there are something interesting fact. Tina has just started to speak up and just tell our viewers that our phone lines are open and the numbers are flashed on your television screen. So if you have any queries, if you have any questions that what you have to eat when you have jaundice or what you, are any of your family members or friends who have been diagnosed with jaundice, what that person should take up as the diet plan. So you have any queries, please ask us. The numbers are flashed on your television screens and Tina is here to give you all the answers. So Tina, coming back to you again, continue.
Now, juices can be taken, but it should be homemade. Not the, you know, with the preservative juices that is found like in packet juices. Those should be avoided. But yes, you can take the homemade juice, like sugarcane juice is good. But it should be, you know, taken out in a clean vessel.
Not the outside.
Not the outside one. Clean vessel. And hygiene is very, very important in this part. You can take like lemon water and then sweet lime mosambino, which is commonly available. It is rich in vitamin C. So it helps in curing your liver. So it is beneficial.
So it, is it good to prepare the juices at home
at
itself
home,
or
right.
the packet items?
No, no. The, it is in terms of a jaundice patient, it is better to prepare at home.
Okay, so you won't suggest the packet?
I never suggest for going for a like packet or ready-made juices. And also the juice that are being sold in the stalls, because in which condition they have prepared.
So what water they have used.
What water and how far they have cleaned their utensil, that is to be noted there. So in that aspect, it is better to prepare at the home. The fresh juice, one can go with that. And the liver, it helps in digesting all sort of food items. So when you put excessive load on that, so it, you know, it hampers in your digestion factor. So in that terms, the saturated fatty food should be avoided. So in the, this case, when people say that you should stop taking oily food items, it is not that oily food. You can take oil, the amount should be less, maybe 10 ml per day. Maybe 10 ml per day, I'll repeat again, and that oil should be like vegetable refined oil. But not that saturated fat like ghee, butter, cream, banaspati, or any kind of like, you know, fatty food items, maybe bakery items, or maybe the packet food items which are being like partially saturated food, partially saturated fatty foods are being mentioned, like trans fat. So those food items should be avoided in case of a jaundice patient. But rather than that, you can take 10 ml of oil at home. In irrespective that if your consultant doctor has asked you to completely avoid it, this is something different.
But
nowadays,
depends on the,
on the consultant doctor. But but as our day-to-day practice with our gastroenterologist, we have seen that in nowadays, in case of jaundice patient, they never stop in taking the regular vegetable refined oil, but the amount has to be controlled. Maybe of 10 ml, as I have mentioned.
So there must be some sigh of relief and good good news for the people out there that you can use oil but in a very small amount and you can have a tasty food, but maybe that it has to be cooked in a very small amount of oil, isn't it?
Yes, very small amount of oil, but saturated fatty food should be completely avoided.
Okay,
you should say completely no to the fatty food unless and until your liver enzymes comes under control. So usually the gastroenterologists, they go for liver function tests. So in that, the enzymes are being seen. So on that note, they write to the patient that what, how long they had to continue with that diet. So there is no certain days that, you know, for 10 days or for 20 days or for 1-3 months you have to continue with the boiled
food.
Yeah, it depends upon in your enzymes how long they take time to come into control. Once they come into control level, so that gastroenterologist will tell you that you can go with your normal food. Mm. But once you have come across this type of like diseases, mm-hmm. or which is related to the liver, okay. it is better to avoid or restrict.
Okay.
The more of like saturated fatty items.
Okay, okay. And how okay. important is the immunity power? At this point in time, does the immunity power comes down and people take a lot of time to get cure,
yes,
and
yes.
the food which they eat is has to be like taken care of very
yeah,
much.
Yeah, right. Hmm. In this aspect, no, the liver enzymes are very important. So mm-hmm. there are certain food which helps in increasing your digestive enzyme, we say
okay.
like that. So that those are like a carrot, mm-hmm. pumpkin,
okay.
Which are like, you know, helps in curing your liver, mm. and it also helps in jaundice patient too.
Okay.
And your berries, you know, mm. blueberry, blackberry, or the you can say the Indian jamuns, which is locally available. Mm. This is also very much beneficial mm. for the jaundice patient. And also like fruits like papaya, ripe papaya is very good.
Mm.
And like pineapple, and if seasonally available, mangoes.
Okay.
So these are helps in your secretion of your liver enzymes.
Mm-hmm.
So so these foods can be included in your
okay.
Diet.
Mm.
So once when a person is diagnosed as a jaundice.
Hmm.
Instead of going for like bread butter in the morning, they can go with a bowl of oats
okay.
prepared with curd, and mm. they can take with that like cut fruits.
Okay.
Maybe a bowl of mm-hmm. muskmelon. This is also very good.
Okay.
Or they can go with like ripe papaya.
Hmm.
And then like juices can be taken in the mid-morning, homemade
okay.
Juices. And you can take some whole wheat pancake and all, or chillas can be prepared
okay.
and you can take in the mid-morning.
Mm-hmm.
And in the noontime, when you go for your usual lunch, that time you can you have to include protein part also.
Okay.
So usually what happened in once, you know, is diagnosed as a jaundice, people stop taking fish, chicken, everything.
Yeah, non-veg is totally stopped.
Yes.
Huh.
But if you stop the non-veg items, then how your liver will be, you know, function properly, because it is affected. When it is affected, it has to rebuild again.
Mm-hmm.
So for protein helps in rebuilding.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to take the protein, but the thing is that you have to cut down the fatty food.
Okay.
We like red meat.
Mm-hmm.
Red meat, no doubt, it contains protein. But another thing is that it contains fat also.
Fat also.
So
huh.
that has to be
So fatty
cut
items
down.
Should be removed.
Yeah, fatty items which contain high protein.
Okay.
Okay. Like
mm-hmm.
red meat, it
mm-hmm.
may be,
mm-hmm.
or maybe of like too fatty fishes. Those has to be cut down. But instead of that, you can take lean protein
okay.
or plant protein is much much beneficial.
Mm-hmm.
You can go with like whole dal, pulses, and then those like green grams, sprouted moong, sprouted this one chana, those can be incorporated in your diet.
Okay.
You can prepare like ghugni, or you can prepare boiled chana, can be mashed with potato, that can be taken along with your regular meal.
Mm-hmm.
And you can take fish also, but the preparation has to be in a very light
way. Manner.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Light way. And while preparing the fish recipes, you have to squeeze some lemon juices, which will help in increasing your vitamin C, and it is also act as an antioxidant to your body.
Okay.
So that can be added with that, and some like spinach and all can be also added. But the thing is that when liver is affected, digestion problems comes.
Okay.
So maybe the raw vegetables or the leafy vegetables cannot be digested
properly.
in some people.
Mm-hmm.
So it
actually
better,
depends
yeah.
on different people.
One
people maybe have a proper digestion, maybe not other.
Not the other one.
Not
if
other
someone
one.
Is having loose motion with jaundice, then one can grind the vegetables and can prepare gravy with that, and can add some chana over there, and can add like fish.
Okay.
You know, small fish can be added and can be prepared and go with that.
Okay.
It is not like that. No, you have to completely stop down everything and you,
actually, that's a notion which is having in everybody's
yes,
mind.
Yes, right.
That,
if you now stop taking your proper
you will not
diet,
get the proper nutrients.
Yeah, your immune system will go down because vitamin C, E, you know, nuts also good.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is that portion size matter.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because nuts in other way, it is like rich in vitamin E, which is a antioxidant. So it boosts our immune system. But the other thing is that if you take in a ample amount, it may sometime, you know, happens to be indigestion problem. So the quantity matters. Mm-hmm. But you can include at least 3-4 pieces of walnut salmon on daily basis, even if a person is having jaundice.
Okay. And suppose, what are the things one should avoid, like the vegetables which you have mentioned? There are also, we also see that one should always have the seasonal kind of vegetables and fruits, which is very important. But then nowadays, all kind of seasoned fruits and vegetables are available in the market. So it is necessary to buy those which are not seasonal vegetables, and is it good for the health?
You know, nowadays supermarkets have come up, so usually
we get all kinds of vegetables
here. Yeah, but the thing is that, yeah, you can go with that. Hmm. But the thing is that you have to see the expiry date and manufacturing and from when they have come to your place. Mm-hmm. You know, those things has to be noted, and then you can go with that.
Okay.
But the locally minor fruits also play a very, very important role.
Okay.
Minor fruits are like, you know, carambola, that is star fruit.
Achha.
You know, cordoi tenga.
Oh.
Yeah, that is very good. We all know that is good for your skin. It is good in curing the jaundice also. So you can prepare gravy and make your fish curry with that. And in fact, you can make pieces of carambola and add while preparing the dal. That is also give you a different taste.
Different taste.
Yeah. When you are on jaundice diet. So, and then you you can go with like that tenga mora, or you know, those type of like minor vegetable garden, vegetable garden herbs. So herbs also are very good in curing your jaundice patient.
Okay.
So that can be grinded or incorporated while preparing your pancake, or you can add while preparing dal or gravy. So it can be taken in that way also. And in fact, like which is known as bell, no, custard apple. So I think bell is custard apple, right?
So if we use that, how we have to use that, and in that form, if we can take it just as a fruit, or we need to prepare something
you can prepare juice with that and can be taken. It helps in digestion. So that bell juice, no, that helps in digestion. So that can be taken. Those are minor fruits and locally available.
Okay.
But you do not have to reach out for QV and avocados and all sort of things, because for common people it is important that you have to go with your kitchen garden foods. But one thing you have to remember, that you should stop taking all sort of carbonated drinks, Coca-Cola, any kind of
sodas
and all. Alcoholic people should stop taking alcohol completely, okay? And then saturated fatty foods like ghee, butter, cream, and like cow milk. Cow milk or buffalo milk, no? The whole milk.
So that has to be fat at this point in time.
Yes. That, because whole milk or whole milk product. Maybe paneer, commonly available local shops paneer, that has to be stopped. Instead of that, you can go with skimmed milk, which is zero cholesterol, comes on the Tetra Pak. That you can opt for it. You can prepare curd with that, and sometime you can make lassi also with that, because curd, as I already mentioned, it helps in your
and one will
curing
have a different taste,
yeah, different
their
taste
buds.
Yeah, right. And like onions and gingers are also good. It is not like, no, you have to stop taking completely your spices. But the thing is that you have to minimize it. Your stomach may not go for some another indigestion problem. That's why in the jaundice patient, usually they say that boil food. But no, herbs or spices also have its own role to play in it, because it is rich in antioxidant. So you can add spices, but whole spices are better. Like onion, garlic, ginger. So this can be added. Yes. And in fact, the ginger, you know, ginger juice can be excreted out. 1 teaspoon of ginger juice, you can add their honey and can be taken.
Yeah, because if one person hears about ginger juice, it will be too much hectic for that person to have that ginger. So honey can be added.
Honey can be added and can be taken because it helps in, you know, detoxifying your liver.
Okay.
And tomato also good. Tomato helps in detoxifying the liver. So mm-hmm. if someone is not having any sort of like gastritis problem,
okay.
so can go with like tomatoes.
Okay, okay. So these are some of the important things and one of the important diet chart. So there are types of jaundice, I guess. So
right.
if you talk about that, what are those?
So there are like, you know, inborn, newborn.
Yeah, newborn baby. Yeah, yeah. How do they get jaundice? Yeah. It's a very like a very tricky question
yes.
to ask on that.
Yes.
So just they are newborn and we just hear that after a few days or 2 to 3 days, a baby has been detected with jaundice. So what
yeah,
would be the reason?
A, newborn babies, they get jaundice. It's a very common nowadays
yeah.
because it is a physiological condition, you can say it.
Mm-hmm.
So in this aspect, it is nothing to worry. It goes
okay.
away. But the thing is that you have to go to see a pediatric doctor.
Mm-hmm.
Under his observation, they will give some treatment.
Mm-hmm.
And the mother has to continue with the breast milk.
Okay.
In this note, I will say one thing.
Mm-hmm.
That if a baby is diagnosed as a jaundice, it is nothing like that. The mother had to stop taking everything. I
okay.
met patient in our pediatric
mm-hmm.
ICU, while, mm-hmm. you know, the baby, newborn baby, it came
okay.
with a jaundice.
Hmm.
The mother started to take the boiled food.
Oh,
so
okay.
I asked, in what concept you are have stopped
mm-hmm.
taking all sort of like food
and
items?
At
and
this point in time, she need all the good
yes.
nutrients.
See, she need all the nutrients because
mm-hmm.
she has to keep on giving
True.
The breast milk to the baby.
True.
Now, if she stopped taking all sort of like good foods
mm-hmm.
and
she'll
stick to
the
boiled food,
food
items,
uh-huh.
then her milk secretion will not be
mm-hmm.
sufficient for the baby.
Mm-hmm.
So as long as it is like, you know, told by the physicians,
mm-hmm.
you should not go for like stopping all sort of like food items,
okay.
you know, and stick to a,
mm-hmm.
a one diet.
Mm-hmm.
And another jaundice, it is there like as it is been same seen as in female patients,
okay.
like obstetric jaundice.
Obstetric.
So, yeah, it is like gynecologists, they
mm-hmm.
they define it properly.
Mm-hmm.
But
mm-hmm.
in dietary terms, I will say that in this case also, you do not have to stop taking everything.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you have to stop only the fatty food items
mm-hmm.
and the
oil
packet.
Should be less.
Yeah, packet.
Mm-hmm.
Packet food items,
packet
food all items. Sort of like processed
mm-hmm.
nuggets
mm-hmm.
and all should be stopped. You go with like minimum amount of vegetable refined oil.
Mm-hmm.
Take ample of fruits,
mm-hmm.
fresh fruits. Papaya,
mm-hmm.
pineapple, mango,
mm-hmm.
berries plays a very, very good role in
okay.
curing the jaundice.
Mm-hmm.
You can go with the citrus fruits like
mm-hmm.
lemon, carambola juices.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, these are also rich
which
in vitamin C.
Which are easily available
yeah.
and they can prepare it and maybe they not to keep it for a long time, but at least they can prepare it for some time and they can have it in small amount,
right, right,
isn't it?
Right.
Hmm.
In fact, like in the small children, they get jaundice. We get many patients in Excel
hmm.
Care Hospital coming with the jaundice.
Hmm.
But looking at their you know, liver function test, the
mm-hmm.
enzymes and all, the pediatric doctor, they suggest the dietitians to plan out a proper meal plan. So when we start giving them
yeah.
Like fish
mm-hmm.
or
do they get
yeah,
a shock that
yeah,
you are
yeah,
telling them
white,
not to have boiled?
Yes, yeah.
Huh.
Obviously the yolk part sometime it has been stopped
okay.
if the enzymes are very high.
Okay.
So but if it is in a, you know, reference range, then SGOPT or SGPT, all these things
mm-hmm.
in a reference range, but maybe bilirubin is high. Some
okay.
we give a whole egg also, but if it is very high, we
mm-hmm.
skip out the yellow part
mm-hmm.
and give
the white
okay. part.
Mm-hmm.
So the parents, they become very curious,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
why you have given such kind of
mm-hmm.
food, but
mm-hmm.
at that time I have to keep on explaining, counseling
mm-hmm.
them.
It becomes
the concept have changed.
Mm-hmm.
The concept, the entire concept have changed now.
Mm-hmm.
It is not that when you get jaundice, you
mm-hmm.
have to skip out all sort of
okay.
like food items,
mm-hmm.
you have to stick to a boiled food items. And
mm-hmm.
in fact, I have seen people, you know, they do not take yellow food items because they
yeah.
think that if they keep on taking yellow food items, they will become more yellow.
So lots of notions, Tina, out there, and we already had a good discussion. So I'm sure the viewers must have be listening now that the concept has changed. It doesn't mean that if you have diagnosed with jaundice or any of your near and dear ones as having jaundice, you will have boiled foods. But a good proper diet should be maintained maintained. What Tina has just mentioned right now, that you can have a proper good diet chart so that you can have a healthy food, you can have some interesting food, and you should not have only stick to boiled foods, which is no one wants to have it anytime. So you can have a small amount of oil to be added, lots of fluid to be added, lots of fruits to be added, and fluid and the juices to be prepared at home. Not all the packet items should be totally stopped. What just Tina has mentioned. Tina, we are really short of time.
Yes.
So thank you so much for coming.
Yes, one thing I'll add on this.
Yes. Just in a quick note, you have to add that because we are just short of time.
The sodium has to be,
checked.
Yeah, checked. Mm-hmm. There's a high sodium rich food should not be taken, and the refined sugar.
Okay.
Refined sugar and simple carbohydrates should be stopped because they put overload to the liver.
Okay, so the sodium has to be checked and no high sugar.
Refined sugar
should be.
And simple carb.
Simple
like maida and
So that has to be
stopped.
That has to be avoided totally.
Yeah. Instead of cereals, they can go with that.
We had really lot to talk, and the time is not allowing us. But I will be taking this topic in our next episodes as well, because there are lots of questions. So thank you, Tina, for coming to our show. And viewers who must be watching Good Life, the health show, must be benefited with all the queries and with all the discussions which we had today. And with this, we have come to the end of the show. We hope that we were able to answer all your queries in the best possible way. And in our next episode, we will be discussing on some other important health issues. So if you have any queries, do join us next Wednesday live at 4 p.m. Until then, stay healthy, stay fit, and keep watching Northeast Live. Goodbye.